And I would like to request Dr. Parikshit to introduce, please.
Good evening. We have Dr. Rishikesh Mai, a very young, dynamic ophthalmologist from Nagpur. He's an alumnus of Shankar Netralaya Chennai and an ex-consultant at Center for Sight, New Delhi. He has presented his work at many national and international conferences. In fact, he's won the Best Podium Presentation Prize in Neuro-Ophthalmology in AIOC 2021. So over to you, Dr. Rishikesh, a rising star in Vidarbha Ophthalmology and Maharashtra Ophthalmology Society.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Parikshit, sir. I'll just share my screen. Okay. It's visible, right?
Yes, Dr. Yes. Rishikesh, we can see it. If you can just do search.
Thank you, Partha sir, and thank you the scientific committee of AIOS for giving me an opportunity to share on an abstract topic about how a good abstract in pediatric ophthalmology should be. I will just skip many of the things which have already been repeated by the speakers. Actually, many of them are from institutional practice. So for a private practitioner, to do a scientific study and to publish or even to present or create an abstract is actually a challenge at times. So, I mean, what I usually followed was I kept on attending the free papers, and I will be presenting one of the free paper which finally got accepted after multiple rejections for the earlier presentations which I did. So as one of my mentors had mentioned, every outpatient has something worth presentable and publishable. So you need to study what is unique about that particular case or for the group of patients which come to you. Choose your topic which you see something unusual in otherwise usual cases, and uniqueness of the study is very important, which I feel many of the times in pediatric ophthalmology or strabismus, we directly jump to topics related to vertical strabismus or complicated squints. But there are a lot of topics like simple refractive errors in children, or what is the effect of different type of dilating drops on patients, or effect of diluted atropine on myopia. These can also be included in the study and are worth publishable actually. Most important is go through the literature search and compare your study with the previous study which has been done, so that to find out what different you have got, and also be genuine. Don't try to manipulate the data to get a desired result. Sometimes no result also is a good result. As already mentioned by Manisha madam, about the title should be crisp and simple. Avoid very long title, and you don't need to put flashy words like demystifying or something like that. It should be very simple and straight, so as to come to the point directly. The second part is the synopsis. The second part of the abstract which you will be submitting, go through the for what you are presenting, because sometimes like in AIOS, we don't need to put in different titles like introduction, methods, results. Simply put in a single paragraph, but something like World Society for Pediatric Ophthalmology and Strabismus, WSPS, it has to be in these headings which you will be presenting, or which abstract has to be submitted. So mention the nature of the study, prospective, retrospective, also the number of participants or the samples, and important result related to aim of the study needs to be mentioned there. That has to be the highlight of whatever you are presenting. So Dr. Amit had already mentioned, the aim and the important part of the result, they should be in sync, they should not be separate. And use simple, understandable words, avoid long sentences, and avoid unnecessary words, which will increase it has to be fit into the word limit, actually. So I'll just briefly mention one work which we had done, which got accepted at AIOS, was the treatment outcomes in childhood ocular myasthenia, a very simple, straightforward heading. It was in a paragraph, but I would like to put it like the first sentence has to be the introduction of the study which you are doing, which should also include followed by the aim of the study. The present study is a prospective analysis over 1 year aimed at evaluating the outcomes of medical treatment in childhood ocular myasthenia. It includes 8 patients, that is the number of patients, the prospective study over 1 year, which presented to us with age group 6 to 15 years. So that is the method, especially the inclusion criteria has been included here. Coming to the results which need to be mentioned, because it was a clinical study, the related to medical treatment, we need to tell about what was the clinical features before, what the medical treatment caused, and what change did happen during the outcome, and also the follow-up period. Like in this patient, in this particular study, we had studied 8 patients. The first part includes the clinical features before the treatment, then the medical treatment which was initiated, pyridostigmine and steroids and things like that, and whether the patients were followed up regularly for 2 years, and then the parameters which were checked during the follow-up. Also, the clinical features which were seen during the follow-up has been mentioned here, and it should cover all the 8 patients which you have committed yourself to. And thus, we concluded the conclusion part, which is related to aim of the study, that the early medical treatment helps in remission, avoids recurrence, and the generalized myasthenia. So in this way, if you write, I think all the ideas or all whatever you want to present becomes crystal clear in the minimum words which are expected out of you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rishikesh. And Parikshit, would you like to discuss, please?
Yes. Can I just share a screen and show a single slide?
Yes, please.
Well, Dr. Rishikesh has explained it succinctly, and we've had a galaxy of speakers, all of them stalwarts in their own right, who have told us about their abstracts. So Dr. Amit, of course, gave a very good this about how an abstract should not be. And in today's work, this, at many places, an abstract is just 100 or 150 words. In many places, it is just 1,000 characters. So sometimes it can be even less. So in that, it has to be succinct. It has to be informative. As Dr. Manisha put it, the aim has to be clear and concise. But then, as Namrata ma'am said, if we put in things like prospective, if it is randomized controlled trial, if we tell exactly what it is. And in fact, for many veterans, what they look at is the methods part of the abstract, because that is the most important one. How was the study done? When was it done? Where was it done? By whom? By which manner? How long? How much was the follow-up? The loss to follow-up? That is more important than the result, which says what was found out. And finally, as Nayak sir said, the conclusion, what does it mean? It should flow from the result. It should not be the other way. We are just concluding what we think is important. We must take a lot of time to write the abstract, because as the speaker said, it is perhaps the most read thing that is there. So it's like a trailer of the film, but the film trailer will show the hottest or the most controversial scenes. That's not with the abstract. It's like a review or a book review that we write. Well, and we also have here Dr. Santosh Honawar, who is the editor of the IJO and a veteran in this. So over to you, Honawar sir.
Santosh is joining in time, but if we can have Rajesh, would you like to make a comment on Rishikesh's presentation?
Yeah, sure. Actually, I was just listening to everyone, and it was a wonderful session. Most of the things have been discussed. Rishikesh presented very well, and it was absolutely crisp and nice. A couple of things, I don't want to be repetitive. A couple of things I would just like to add that, what he was also trying to indicate that, in a structured abstract, it is very easy to, write that, okay, it's structured, like divided into objective, method, result, and conclusion. But certain times in unstructured abstracts, what happens that the sequence again should be like that only, but they sometimes the sequence is not that. And while reviewing a few of the case series and a case report, I could figure out that that sequence is lost. So that one has to be careful. And one thing I would like to add, one more thing which probably has not been mentioned here is that many times we derive causal relationship from something which from a design of study which is not meant for causal relationship. Like suppose a case of presenile cataracts, if you have done a case series of presenile cataracts and you got something in the aqueous tap, some finding, some mediator, something like that, we cannot extrapolate and we cannot say that presenile cataract is caused by that. Because for causal relationship, you need to do a randomized study. So that is, these are a couple of things which I wanted to add, because many times in conclusion, there's a general habit that if we get something, suppose I get some mediator in the aqueous tap in all the presenile cataracts, or then I will say that this can cause presenile cataract. We cannot say that. So that is something which we have to understand, that what is the design of study and what conclusion we can derive from that.
Thank you very much, Raj.